The Diamond Model is a foundational cyber threat intelligence tool that you must learn how to use. Used effectively, it will reveal questions to ask about an attack, allow you to group intrusions and track attack campaigns and threat actors. Let me show you how. Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Adam and this channel is all about cyber threat intelligence. I've helped build CTI teams and train clients on best practices. If you want to learn it all for free, subscribe to this channel. The Diamond Model is a framework for analyzing cyber intrusions and mapping the relationships between the attacker, their tools, and the infrastructure used to perform an attack. It is used throughout the CTI world to understand and track cyber attacks. Let's explore how you can start using this model to elevate your cyber threat intelligence skill set. The Diamond Model is a simple framework for analyzing and understanding cyber threats. Defenders use it to organize and structure their intrusion analysis by categorizing data into one of its four components. You have adversary, who did the attack. Then you have capability, how did they do it? Next up is victim, who was the target? And finally we have infrastructure, what was used to perform the attack? These four components are present in every cyber attack and relate to one another. In its simplest form, the model describes how an adversary deploys a capability over some infrastructure against the victim, allowing an analyst to visualize the relationships between the key data points that fall under these categories. Models like the attack kill chain and MITRE attack matrix highlight the tactics, techniques, and procedures, or TTPs, seen during an incident, or the infrastructure used. However, they fall short of connecting the dots and generating tactical or strategic intelligence. The Diamond Model's holistic view of a cyber threat allows an analyst to better understand an intrusion, attack campaign, or adversary by taking a bird's eye view of an intrusion, only showing the key indicators. Let's examine each of the four components of the Diamond Model to better understand how it does this. The adversary is who is behind an attack. It could be a nation state, script kiddie, or cyber criminal who performed the attack. You can break the adversary down into two main roles. You have the adversary operator, who is the individual directly performing the attack. And then you have the adversary customer, the entity that benefits from the attack being performed. An adversary can assume both of these roles or just one. Typically, a high-profile cyber attack will involve multiple operational teams, one for the initial access, another for developing the malware, and a third for exfiltrating the data. The ransomware scene has adopted this structure, where you will have an initial access broker providing a service, a ransomware gang licensing their software, or ransomware, and an affiliate actually performing the attack. The number of operational teams and the structure of who is actually performing the attack can get quite complicated. Nation states will use proxy groups, ransomware gangs will use affiliates, and the link between government operations and government sanctioned operations can become quite blurry. As such, it is usually more productive to track the adversary customer who benefits most from the attack, rather than the specific individuals involved or the malware used. This will allow you to correlate these adversary data points with other campaigns and more accurately attribute the attacks to an entity or campaign based on available data. Capability refers to the tactics, techniques, and procedures, or TTPs, the adversary uses to perform the attack. This can be categorized into tools, the hacking tools, malware, or exploit used during an attack, and the tradecraft, the hacking techniques used by the adversary, like living off the LAN binaries and scripts, or the commands run on systems. The MITRE attack matrix covers these pretty well. When mapping capabilities to the Diamond Model, you want to focus on specifics. General tools or tradecraft are not very useful if you want to track them. Focus on data points that stand out, usually represented by choices an adversary will have to make, like specific malware configuration options chosen, custom malware used, or novel attack techniques or command line options. These can be considered key indicators, indicators that remain consistent across intrusions, uniquely distinguish an attack campaign, and align with a phase of the cyber kill chain. They are indicators that you can use to track attack campaigns or threat actors, differentiate between intrusions, and hunt for this activity in your environment. An adversary will deploy their capabilities using infrastructure. This is anything an attacker can use to deliver their capabilities. It can be physical, like a command and control server or C2, or logical, like an email address or service account. The attacker may use their infrastructure directly, such as a C2 server they connect to when performing their attacks, or something the victim connects to, like a third-party file sharing service where data is exfiltrated to, think file.io or pastebin. Almost anything can be infrastructure, from the process that runs a malicious DLL, to the name badge an attacker cloned to gain access to the target building. Don't just think of domains and IP addresses as infrastructure. Some common types of infrastructure you will come across regularly include service accounts, email addresses, IP addresses, domains, C2 servers, personas, like social media handles, phone numbers, Telegram channels and more, or cloud services and file sharing websites. You may also come across Tor nodes and compromised websites as part of infrastructure. The victim is the recipient of the attack, or capabilities deployed across the infrastructure by the adversary. The victim is either an individual or an organization with assets impacted by an attack, like computer systems, networks, or data. Victims rarely have a direct relation to the attacker. Instead, they are connected by infrastructure or capability. A victim is just a means to an end for the adversary. A threat actor's intention is to compromise the confidentiality, integrity, or availability of the data or services a victim controls. They do not care about the victim. They only care about the assets the victim holds and the benefits they can gain from exploiting them. It is also important to keep track of who the actual victim is during an attack. An attacker may compromise a software vendor to perform a supply chain attack against their real target. The actual victim of the attack will mean different things for your analysis. An analyst can use the Diamond model from different viewpoints. They could take the victim's view and look for the infrastructure or capability that links to an attacker. They could be an infrastructure provider and look for the attackers targeting victims using their services. Or they could even take the attacker's viewpoint and use capability and infrastructure to find a victim. This pivoting aspect of the model, where you start at one component and move to another, is what makes it so useful for threat intelligence analysis. As an analyst, you can use the model to find questions that will generate leads, insight, and actionable intelligence for you to use. To understand how these four components interact and how to use the model effectively, you need to know the axioms on which the Diamond model was built. These accepted assumptions are fundamental to using the model appropriately. Before we do that though, let me know if you use any analysis techniques in your work in the comments. Do you use the cyber kill chain, the MITRE ATT&CK framework, or do you use something else that I haven't mentioned here? Maybe you already use the Diamond model and this is just a refresher. Let me know in the comments, I'd love to hear about it. Sergio Caltagirone, the model's co-creator, outlined the axioms that underpin the Diamond model's creation and operation in a blog post entitled The Laws of Cyber Threats, Diamond Model Axioms. These assumptions dictate how every cyber attack can be analyzed through the lens of the Diamond model. Axiom 1 reads, for every intrusion event, there exists an adversary taking a step towards an intended goal by using a capability over infrastructure against a victim to produce a result. This is the entire underpinning of the model. Every cyber attack involves an adversary with an objective. This objective is achieved by developing a capability, or TTP, that is delivered to the victim through some form of infrastructure. Using this fundamental truth, you can analyze an attack and draw your insights. Axiom 2 says there exists a set of adversaries, insiders, outsiders, individuals, groups, and organizations which seek to compromise the computer systems or networks to further their intent and satisfy their needs. There are always bad guys somewhere who want to access your data and affect the services you provide, whether for financial, political, or personal gain. Understanding an adversary's intention can help you develop strategies to defend against their actions. This is why there is an adversary in every attack. The third axiom states every system, and by extension every victim asset, has vulnerabilities and exposures. This just boils down to every computer system and network having vulnerabilities that a threat actor can exploit. You should assume that your systems will get breached at some point, regardless of how expensive or up to date they are. You need to take precautionary actions that assume they will be breached and allow you to protect your critical assets even if they are. On to number four. This states that every malicious activity contains two or more phases which must be successfully executed in succession to achieve the desired result. This relates to the idea of the cyber kill chain, whereby an attacker must perform several steps to be successful in their cyber attack, from initial reconnaissance to actions on objective. Assuming an attack must go through these steps gives you points where you can detect and prevent it. On to axiom number five. This states that every intrusion event requires one or more external resources to be satisfied prior to success. This highlights that adversaries cannot exist in a vacuum. They require software, hardware, network access, and technical or financial resources to perform an attack. This leads to the key components of infrastructure and victim. An adversary must use infrastructure and must have access to a victim to be successful. On to number six. This one says that a relationship always exists between an adversary and their victim, even if it's distant, fleeting, or indirect. A threat actor will always target a victim for a reason. The reason could be because they found out they were vulnerable to an easily exploitable vulnerability after they ran a mass scan across the internet, or that they were a specific political or financial target. The final axiom states that there exists a subset of the set of adversaries which have the motivation, resources, and capabilities to sustain malicious effects for a significant length of time against one or more victims while resisting mitigation efforts. Adversary-victim relationships in this subset are called persistent adversary relationships. This relates to the advanced persistent threats, or APTs. These threat actors have unlimited resources, like time, money, and people, to sustain prolonged operations against the victim. Who this is will depend on the adversary-victim relationship. And just because an adversary is persistent against one victim, it does not mean they are persistent against all their victims. A good example of APTs are nation states, like the United States, China, and Russia, which have been conducting long-term cyber operations against each other for decades. The theory is great, but when should you actually use the Diamond Model, and how can you use it? Let's examine some use cases. As a case study, we will use this excellent article by the DFIR report team entitled "A Truly Graceful Wipeout." This report details a multi-stage intrusion in which attackers delivered TrueBot malware via an email disguised as a fake Adobe Acrobat document. This allowed them to gain initial access, where they then deployed the destructive MBR killer wiper. We will only briefly cover the intrusion and focus on applying the Diamond Model to certain stages. I highly recommend reading the full report and following the DFIR team for more details. The best way to apply the Diamond Model to real-world use cases is to combine it with a complementary attack framework like the cyber kill chain. Think of each stage of the cyber kill chain as having an associated Diamond Model with it, where every data point or piece of evidence you collect related to that stage can be mapped to an adversary, victim, infrastructure, or capability. Aim to fill each Diamond Model component with as much data as possible for every stage of the kill chain. Some stages will be more difficult than others, and you may find that some stages don't involve an adversary or victim at all. Nevertheless, one component must be populated for each stage of the kill chain, and at least between stages 2, weaponization, and 6, command and control, to declare your analysis of an intrusion complete. Any gaps you find represent an intelligence requirement that must be fulfilled with supplementary data. This could include additional intelligence gathering, malware analysis, reverse engineering, or digital forensics. Based on your data, you can also assign each link between components a confidence level. This lets you qualify the assessments you make using the model with estimative language. In this case study, let's just focus on the delivery, installation, and command and control stages to keep this demo simple and short. During the delivery stage of this attack, the threat actor behind the intrusion used email as their initial delivery mechanism. They sent a phishing email to employees that redirected through a series of URLs before downloading a fake Adobe Acrobat document that was actually a TrueBot malware executable. Then, in the installation phase, after gaining initial access to a corporate workstation, the attackers used scheduled tasks and local administrator accounts with RDP access for persistence. These persistence mechanisms, created using PowerShell, gave the attackers an RDP connection to the compromised workstations. The IP addresses found are ones the flawed Grace malware reached out to as part of the scheduled tasks and the RDP connections that were successful. Finally, to gain command and control over these systems, the attackers deployed TrueBot, Flawed Grace, and Cobalt Strike malware to pivot around the corporate network and perform their malicious actions. They communicated with their C2 agents through common web protocols like HTTPS and custom protocols on port 443. The network infrastructure used by the adversaries has been seen before in previous campaigns by Fin11 and Lace Tempest, meaning they can now be labeled as the adversary for this intrusion. Once you have concluded your analysis of each kill chain stage, you can merge your individual diamond models into one big one, as the team at the DFI report have done in their report. However, it is often useful to keep the stage-specific models to compare them against other intrusions and cluster data together to track capabilities, campaigns, and actors at each of the stages of an attack. These three diamond models allow you to begin asking questions about your dataset, pivot to new intelligence, and connect the dots. You could ask, what adversary is related to the infrastructure I am seeing? Or what capabilities do these adversaries have that I could look for in my environment during a threat hunt? You could even ask, what are the goals this adversary is trying to achieve, and what vulnerabilities will they try to exploit? The Diamond Model is an essential tool in your cyber threat intelligence arsenal. It allows you to ask the right questions about your intrusion dataset and pivot to find the answers. All CTI analysts should know and understand how to use this model to perform intrusion analysis that can be shared with the wider cybersecurity community. Practice using the Diamond Model by mapping out the rest of the attack described in the DFI article I showcased in this video's demo. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a like to let me know you want to see more content like this. Also, take a look at this video on the cyber kill chain to learn more about this key analytical technique used across the cybersecurity industry. Stay tuned for more cyber threat intelligence content and technical analysis.